You're out promoting your first newborn child.
Yeah, pretty much.
Is that fun? Is it exciting to be here with your baby?
Yeah, really exciting. I've had lots of fun, and now it's down to the serious nitty gritty of screening the film and talking to people about it. And yeah, but I've had a great time. I've never been to Toronto before, so.
This is your first trip to the festival?
Yeah.
But you've had a lot of movies here.
Yeah, I've always been busy.
So you're always doing something other than being here.
I'm always working on another film. I'm always acting. So then you kind of, your schedule doesn't work, and so you can't come. But I was available. I was like, yeah, brilliant.
So how much time did you have to take off of your schedule of acting to do your movie?
Nearly 2 years. But so I was able to do the messenger in between writing and shooting. So they were great. They had me go out to America for just a couple of weeks to shoot my stuff, and then back home to start my own film.
So how was that experience? You worked with Woody and with Ben.
Yeah.
On that, was that fun to just chop into? Was it that the part was so good that you wanted to jump into it, or?
Well, it's quite simple. I knew Oren from Jesus Son, and over the years I've been trying to work with him. Things haven't worked out, and all the rest of it. And then this film came about, and asked if I'd do it, and I thought it was an incredible script, very beautiful, very truthful, very brave. And the cast was incredible, and you know, kind of something that one can't turn down, really.
Yeah, it was a bit of a surprise. I mean, we've had a few movies that have tried to get into this subject a little bit, and they've kind of been either too right-wing or too left-wing or something. Yeah. This one just really was human.
I think for me in particular, it does deal with the stuff back home, what other people have to go through back home, and I thought that was quite a beautiful thread, really.
So this movie is, from reading the notes, you're back home on some level.
Yeah? Semi-autobiographical, yeah. I say semi because there are certain things that I've had to change because of real people or respecting people that are still alive, and I don't want to offend them. So things have changed, but it's I was taken into care as a baby, and I was in the care of the local authority till I was 16. So. And then you live in a homeless hostel, and then till you sort yourself out. So, yeah, it's very personal. Yeah.
How did you decide that you wanted to do that?
To make the film.
To get into this particular subject, yeah.
It's quite complicated. I wrote a play when I was 16. In a theatre space, and then friends of mine devised, so I had the idea of the structure of this play, and then friends of mine devised it, and we kind of acted together, and we did this play that was called TWOC, which stands for Taking Without Owner's Consent, about young people that are in the care system, that are abused, and how they deal with it, and how they turn things on themselves, and we did the play, and we had a really good time, and then the play changed when I was trying to write the screenplay into something that happened in 1989, which was the two main unions in England, NALGO and NUPI, which were the unions for the social workers, went on strike. And there was 3 days when these kids were just pretty much left abandoned, and it was quite, you know, at the time it was major because it was the first Children's Act reform since the 1940s. So my first script was really political, and it was it was all based on, you know, truth, but it was very kind of political, and but very overtly political, and all to do. I mean, there were so many characters, and it was you know, I was trying to say too much. And then I was also trying to get other people to make it. I said I wanted to kind of write it, but someone else should direct it. And then the more and more I tried to sell this film to people and talk to them about it, the story over the years, the story changed and turned into a very simple story about a little girl that gets taken into care through no fault of her own and how she feels. That's all, just how this person feels. And the more and more I spoke about it, and the more different producers I met, and there was at one time someone was going to produce it, and they said, oh, I'll give you £250,000 to make it, and you know, you've got to shoot it on digital, and you've got to make it in 2 weeks, and all these, and I said, oh no, and I took my baby, and I was like, oh no, no, and the right person would be out there to help me make it, and then I met Kate, who I'd known years earlier, because she produced Under the Skin, a film I did, as an actor, obviously, and And I was telling her about it, and she said, you just, the way you talk about it, it's your film, you know, mm-hmm. from telling her how I wanted it to look, to how, what film, types of film stock I was interested in, to the composition, to the pace, to the music, to talking about film references, in order to entice her to want to be part of it.
Mm-hmm.
And then we just, she just said, right, we've just got to schedule a date when you're going to make it. That's what you've got to do. You know mm-hmm. that, Sam. I was like, yeah, okay. And she said, so when are you going to do it? And I said, well, let's, because all of us, you're there. And then all of a sudden you're thinking,
the pressure's
shit.
On.
Oh, excuse my language. Fuck, I've got to make this now. Okay. And so we scheduled it. And then it took us about a year to raise the money. And mm-hmm. then... And the rest is history, and yeah.
So how did you know all those things? I mean, are you somebody who's paying attention to everything that's being done on the set while you work as an actor, or all those details?
I'd be lying if I didn't say that things haven't gone in. They must have gone in. I've been on a film set for most of my life now, yeah. you know, and most of my adult life, certainly. And I tend to work quite a lot. I love my job, and mm-hmm. I'm, busy bee. But I think I'm too method to be the kind of person that's like, how's he doing that? And how's she doing that? And
mm-hmm.
Because I never thought I want to be a director one day. So
right.
I was just letting them get on with their stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm ridiculously focused all the time,
right.
like an athlete on a start mark, in case they need me.
Mm-hmm.
In case, they've lit the room quicker than they thought they were going to. Or,
right.
or we're going to lose the light. Everyone gets mm-hmm. to get. So I find that I'm ridiculously focused at work, very much in character,
right.
a lot of the time. Not so much that I can't have lunch with everyone on the dining bus, but I'm
yeah.
very focused. What I realized was that my love of film, and I got this through my partner, because I didn't grow up watching film really.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up watching a lot of TV, and then I kind of got into film, and then I
mm-hmm.
you're busy and you don't get to the cinema. So I started my partner's a director,
mm-hmm.
and we've got a massive film library. So the thing is, I just watch loads and loads of films all the time,
mm-hmm.
almost like I was going to do a degree or a thesis on it.
Right.
And about 3 years ago, I saw The American Friend, the Wim Wenders film, for the
mm-hmm.
first time, and I fell in love with the cinematography and the colours, and I just thought, oh, wow. And so that really stayed with me. And Ozu, I'm a huge Ozu fan, so I think, and Aki Kaurismäki, so I think I've been very,
mm-hmm.
very affected by other filmmakers
mm-hmm.
in regards to composition and style and pace and
mm-hmm.
time. So I think that the people that I've worked with that are amazing,
right.
I didn't get the opportunity to go, how are they doing this? Because I was...
So Wenders ended up being one of your big hooks for this?
I think so, yeah.
It's interesting.
Yeah. I've never worked with him. I've met him once on a plane, but I...
Because it always, you look at this and you go think of Loach and you think of,
Do you really?
I think so. The British neorealists, I guess.
But it's such a still film. It's the most... I mean,
Well, you like to hold your frame.
Yeah.
So you're secretly Japanese this whole time. So you're trying to tell us.
Yeah, somewhere. No.
But you knew. So you had really. You didn't. Did you? I guess you storyboarded. But
as
did you even
as
need
I'm
to?
Really, I'm not very good at drawing. But I did tell you at the beginning of us talking that it was semi-autobiographical. So
mm-hmm.
if I'm taking a cameraman, a cinematographer, back to my hometown,
right.
to places where I grew up, to things that I saw. That's not rocket science. I'm going, this is the shot, okay? And I'm getting the camera, and I'm going, that's the shot, okay? Right.
And you actually did that? You went back to home, that you shot everything?
Everything is in Nottingham, near my hometown, everything.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going, the only location that I never lived in was Crop Row, because we had to build a, it had to be a fictional children's home with fictional
mm-hmm.
characters. I can't use real people.
Right.
Or real characters that I knew.
Mm-hmm.
So... That to me, it was about finding photographs and films that I could show to my cinematographer
mm-hmm.
and my camera operator and go, this is the feel, this is what we're aiming for,
Which Ridley Scott does too. I mean, he's done a lot of movies, so there are a lot of directors out there who do that. So you just decided what the pace was in these places when you decided, how to keep a frame?
I knew that, first of all, I didn't have a lot of time.
Mm-hmm.
And I knew that I needed the film to be very, very still when Lucy was alone.
Mm-hmm.
But when she was in the children's home, it had to be a different energy, a
right.
different animal, because you had to feel as disorientated as she feels.
Mm-hmm.
So it was about, and Johnny Dunn, who was my grip, who's
mm-hmm.
my angel, was someone that I worked very closely with in regard to when I would tell him when I needed to move the camera. Mm-hmm. I had music played a lot on set as well. So Lucy mm-hmm. was performing to music all the time that we would film mute. So, or mm-hmm. I'd just film and we'd record the sound of the music and right. change it later kind of thing.
So how was it finding her?
Not very easy for me, but I think for Shaheen Beg, who cast the movie, mm-hmm. We were spoilt for choice for wonderful little children in Nottingham mm-hmm. who could have been a version of Lucy.
Right.
The reason why Molly kept haunting me was I met her a year before we made the film. I went down, I met all these kids, and she just seemed so adult. Mm-hmm. She seemed so professional, but not precocious, but professional. And I thought, you know, I'm going to need a little kid who can work long hours, who I can communicate with the mum, the dad. Mm-hmm. I need someone that I'm going to be able to take care of. You know, are you eating properly? You know, cuddles, have lots of fun. Mm-hmm. Someone that I felt came from a really warm, safe home life, you mm-hmm. know, so that she was going to be okay. And I also needed someone who had faith. I needed someone mm-hmm. that believed in God, because this mm. little girl had to believe in God in a way that was quite profound. Mm-hmm. Because throughout the film, it's Lucy's faith that gets her through, I believe. Mm-hmm. And so I asked a question to the room, and I said to all these kids, I said, anyone here believe in God? And there's loads of kids like, what, you know? And Molly went, yeah, she was just like, yeah, I believe in God, okay, mm-hmm. end of. And I knew I'd got my Lucy.
Was it like casting yourself? I mean, was that part of it for you at all?
No, because if anything, I'm more like, when I was little, I was more like Lauren, the big one. So, there's a bit of me all over the place. It's like that though, isn't it, when you're, mm-hmm. and when something's personal. No, I think...
Well, in some ways, the way you shoot her, I think, reminds me watching the movie of watching you act.
Really?
Because you're a very eye actor. You know, we look into your eyes in a screen and a still shot, which a lot of directors have figured out about you, I think, right. and you get a lot out of your eyes. And I think yeah. the same thing is true of her in this movie is, you know, she's very strong center. Mm. And so you can let your frame linger on her and still get something out of it. You know, she's completely there.
Sometimes moments can happen after the moment that was meant to happen, if you get mm-hmm. get what I mean. So that's why I think a lot of the time with certain scenes, I've left shots a little mm-hmm. bit too long because it makes you slightly uncomfortable and you think, is it going to be over? No, it's not. And, mm-hmm. and it's at that point that I believe people feel how she feels. Mm. And that's hopefully my through with this film. That there will be moments where people feel very uncomfortable mm-hmm. with my choices as how long these shots are, or how still they are, how close they are. Mm-hmm. And there'll be people out there going, oh, get over it already. Okay, we get the point. Yeah, she's there. All right, we get it. But that's not what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to make people... Okay, when I was trying to raise the money for the film, mm-hmm. it was easy being Samantha Morton and getting the doors open. People going, yeah, well, Samantha Morton wants to make a film. Okay, yeah, we'll listen. Mm-hmm. Okay. But the hardest thing was getting them to believe in me as a director when I hadn't made a short. Mm-hmm. I'd written short stories that had been published as a writer, but I hadn't had anything to say other than my work as an actor. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to convince people in this story. And originally they thought it was going to be some kind of handheld docudrama, like a Kathy Come Home or whatever,
right.
very kind of realism. And I said, no, it can't be that, because then what we're doing is we're then showing the audience mm-hmm. everything. And I wanted the audience to feel everything she felt mm-hmm. through sound, heightened sound, and then sound suddenly disappearing from the film completely and making choices like that make you feel something all the time for her mm-hmm. from a kind of very feminine way.
Well, there's something a little Ramsay-esque about that as well, no?
Is there?
Yeah, well, I mean, a lot of Lynn always, you know, agitates with the camera a bit. I mean, that's the thing. I don't know where I'm interested where all the different pieces come from.
The cinematographer was Tom Townend, who did Morven Keller. Mm-hmm. So, and I met him on Morven Keller. So, and he's worked with Lynn a lot. Although Alvin Kushler is Lynn's cinematographer. Mm-hmm. Tom was his operator. This mm-hmm. was the first feature that Tom did as a cinematographer. So there's a history there. Mm-hmm. Gosh, and through my years of working as an actor, I've met some incredible crew that came on board on the you know, the journey with me. Colin Mooney, who edited the film, I'd never worked with as an actor, but he worked a lot with Peter Mullen and David McKenzie, and so he's able to work with actors, you know what I mean, and get and help us.
So what was it like when you finally, you got the funding and you are going to go start making a movie? And it is your first time directing, so what is, does it feel different going onto that set? How big a change is it?
I tell you what it is, and this is where I was so blessed, and I don't know how people do it when they've never even been on, you know, really made anything, is I've been on a film set forever. It is like second nature to me. So you imagine I'm there, and I'm aware of how everything is. I know how long it's going to take to light a set. I felt like I've already been to school in a way, to do with the set and the structure of a set, and taking care of my crew and what they need, and making sure every day. And this, you know, this doesn't. I was lucky, you know, I had a great time, but I know that if I get to make a film again, it might not be this good. But you know, every night we had our shot list and we stuck to it the next day, and we were very organized. And Mike Elliott, who's my co-producer but also my first AD, is someone I've known since I did Pandemonium when I was 19, 20. So if you have these people around that you absolutely trust at their job, you let them do their job and they're going to do it brilliantly. You know, so. You know, I wasn't by the monitor, I was with my actors, and trust my cameraman, Tom, you know, and I, you know, and then I can watch the monitor later. So it is, I think that it didn't feel like my first time. And that sounds really arrogant.
No, I don't think it sounds arrogant at all.
It just felt like being at home.
It's how you feel.
Yeah. The bit that was really odd, after being with all the crew and all the kids every day, for 6 weeks, 5 day weeks we shot, was the edit all of a sudden. But I was on the phone to Colin every day anyway, because I'd be saying to him things like, just to kind of back me up, I'd say, I want to do this shot and then I want to do that. That's going to cut together, yeah? I can do that, yeah? And he'd be like, you can do anything you want, Sam. And I go, are you sure? That's going to, because I think they're thinking I'm insane on the floor, man. Is that all right? And they're, yeah, it's fine. So I go back and say, it's fine. Colin says, it's fine.
And was he doing an assembly as you went, or?
Yeah.
So how was that when you first saw your first assembly?
Oh, I loved it. I said, that's it. We got the film.
See, it's funny because a lot of directors are crushed by their first assembly.
Really? Oh, I loved it. But it was about 5 hours long.
But you were still happy.
Oh, very. Yeah. I thought it was great.
She released the 5 hour version on DVD.
No, but there is a I'm very happy with the cut we have. That's the film I wanted to deliver. But there's certainly, like, I used to think as an actor I didn't like this extra business that you get in the DVD thing. What's the point in that? Who needs to see the bits that you didn't use? But there's so many brilliant scenes that aren't in the film with the other actors that didn't belong in the film. You put them there and it's like throwing spaghetti at a wall. It kind of falls off when it's ready. It doesn't. There are things that I was so convinced needed to be in the film, and then when you shoot them and you make them and you're kind of trying to stick it, it just doesn't want to be there. But then I feel bad for some of the actors because they did these amazing scenes, and you think people should see that, but they don't belong in the film.
But it was comfortable for you in post to make those cuts.
Yeah,
you didn't have any problem with that?
No.
It sounds like a very relaxed experience.
No, there was one thing that I was really frightened of, because there was a big scene that cost a lot of money that we did, and it was lots of planning on everyone's part, and it was, you know, we were all there, and I know it cost a lot of money, and I got other, you know, it was a big. It was like a 3 day, it was one scene, it took 3 days to shoot, and I, you know, it was really, I'd planned this for, you know, a very long time, and then I was in the edit, and I was like, you don't need it, it's too over the top, we've got to get rid of it. And I remember making the phone call to the exec producer and saying, the riot scene, it's gone. What? And they came over and they watched it, and I said, you see, the thing that hurts the most is that she doesn't have a mother, and that's what she wants, and that has to be the ultimate thing at the end. Right. That this, all she wants is a mum, and she doesn't get one. That you start throwing in loads of other kind of story points that real and are brilliant and are meant in a way worked in the script, but then you're trying to make the film and it tells you what it wants and it tells you what it doesn't want. And I think the good thing for me, because we didn't make it for a lot of money, was I had the freedom to do that. If I'd have made it for $150 million and I'd spent 20 million on a 3 day, you know, technocranes and, you know, big setups and 50 extras or what, 50 million extras or whatever. Try saying that, oh, it's got to go.
Well, see, they do that too. On the $150 million movies, they do cut things like that.
Do they?
It's when you do like the $12 million movie that it's a big problem. You spend half a million on a day or whatever. Because like, yeah, like Star Trek was completely recut and recolor, all kinds of stuff, redone
really?
After they locked the movie the first time. Because the director just decided he wanted to change it all. So they went and they rescored it, they did this.
Oh, well, that's good for him.
But they had spent like $200 million on the movie, so they spent another 20 or whatever it was.
I just lost one scene that didn't really need
one little
to be
tiny
there.
Scene. Yeah. And it sounds like you had a very supportive team around you.
I
was
did.
Willing
I
to
had,
go there, were
I,
you?
I mean, I think that, yeah, I did. I had people that trusted me enough to want to be there with me on that journey. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Can you imagine doing this with something, that, a piece of material that you weren't as committed to, that wasn't as important to you?
I wouldn't have done it. No. So, no, it wouldn't have happened.
So the next one won't be, well, if there is a next one, or is there going to be a next directorial?
Yes, I'd like to do something else. I've got mm-hmm. a couple of things up my sleeve, yeah, now. But my acting, I love acting, and I've got a year mm-hmm. of acting coming up, so.
So you need a little time away from that. So that's, for you, it's the balance, is you're definitely like love acting. You're not, like, ready to get out of that profession
not
to go become
all,
a director.
No way. I think I could do, I think there's room for both in my life.
Mm-hmm.
But not, I mean, I don't think I'll be very prolific as a filmmaker. Like, the next thing I have to say is too very personal.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing I want to do is not very personal, but I have a passion for it.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll see.
Was there any pushing to try to get you in the movie?
What, in The Unloved?
Yes.
Oh, of course. And I've said, yeah, I'll play the mum, yeah. And then I said, no, I'm not going to.
You tricked them. And how is that all now? I mean, so you're still loving acting?
Yes.
And
The Messenger coming out. We talked about that, didn't
yeah,
we?
Yeah, The Messenger's coming. So, but there are other, I mean, you're going to work for another year, so I guess that's, what, two or three movies you're doing at least?
Two
movies.
A movie with Andrew Stanton called mm-hmm. John Carter of Mars, starting January. And then I'm doing a film with a director called Kurum Longi, mm-hmm. and it's his first feature with Chiwetel mm-hmm. at four, and it's a two-hander that I'm very excited about.
So doing something like John Carter of Mars is another giant project, pretty much. Is that exciting? Is that fun to go play? Is that
very
what it feels
excited,
like?
Excited, yeah.
So is it a very intense character, or do you get to...
I'm not going to tell you.
You're not going to tell me anything?
No.
They've been working on this script for so long. This is like a project that's been around for the last 15 years. And they finally got it together at Pixar.
I'm not saying nothing.
I'm not asking you to say anything. I didn't mean for you to break any...
No, I'm not. I'm not, but I'm so excited, yeah, beyond, because I think he's a genius.
He rather
I'm
is.
Very, very proud to be involved.
So do you think in a career fashion at this point? I mean, you've been doing it for so long. You've obviously established yourself. Do you think... Okay, this is, you know, I should do this, or I need to fill in the voids.
Okay,
or
in between making the movie, I had a baby, yeah, mm-hmm. and I've just literally gone, okay, now I'm going to have a bit of time at home and go to the, sounds really silly, but she was 8 weeks old when I started making The Unloved,
mm-hmm.
and I want to go swimming, I want to go to the gym, I want to do some yoga, I want to lose some weight, I want to feel good, I want to, mm-hmm. I'm just tired, so it's me time for
right.
a bit to get health, you know, get kind of strong, ready
right.
for my next.
How is that with the baby to be on that, to have a show that quick to your?
Well, what was good was that I wrote from, I think we met every morning at, it was 9 a.m. we met, and we'd start work at 9, mm-hmm. and I'd be finished by midday, and I was breastfeeding anyway, so she'd just sit there going, while we wrote. And then uh-huh. and then when I was making the movie, what was great for me is that, you know, location, everything was prepped a long time before. So I prepped mm-hmm. it all while I was pregnant, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So this is this, and this is going to happen here, and this is this. And the shoot was 6 weeks. 5.5 weeks, yeah. Tiny shoot.
Yeah.
And we could only shoot 10-hour days because we've got kids.
Right.
5-day weeks.
And your own.
We've got kids and my own children, yeah. So it was kind to me, and it was kind to my family, so.
There are people who would say that that's a lot of emotional commitment to be taking on in the same time.
Well, you get the money. The money in game, and you're like, I said to Kate, the producer, I said, yeah, it's great, we've got the money. And then I said, but the thing is that I'm pregnant. She went, oh my gosh, that's brilliant, but are you still going to be able to make the film? I said, of course I will, yeah.
So do you think the baby's going to be looking for sets for the rest of her life?
What do you mean?
She'll be like used to being on a set from the beginning of...
Oh, that's very sweet. My eldest daughter and a lot of people, a lot of actors that have their children, I don't have what's called a trailer baby. They have lives. They do other stuff.
Ah, okay. You know, yeah. That's a good thing. A real life.
They have a real life with things that they do. This doesn't just revolve around me and work. And so, yeah.
So have you screened the movie here yet?
Toronto.
Yes.
Yeah.
So what was that experience? What was the experience
they
of seeing it with a?
And well, first of all, they were there. They were there. It was packed. So I was really.
That was your first surprise. You didn't expect the room to be full.
There. Yeah. And then, secondly, they stayed till the end, which is a good thing. And you could hear a pin drop, and then everyone clapped, and then there were people crying, and I was just over the moon. I'm just thrilled.
Have you been with a big audience before? Is it?
In the UK, we had a couple of screenings at BAFTA, so maybe 200 people. But this screen was huge, and it looked beautiful, and it was like, it's at home, and I was really thrilled. So the sound was amazing in the cinema.
So is it like going to your prom? I mean, is it... Are you listening to every?
But yeah, I was. The thing about the film is that it's a very. At times, it's incredibly loud and incredibly quiet. Mm-hmm. And I was really nervous that the projectionist and the people in the sound would be like, "Are you sure you want us to turn it up?" I said, "Yeah," because they always turn it down a bit. And I was like, "Make sure it's up. Mm-hmm. Make sure it's up."
And did you listen to what the audience was? How the audience was reacting through the whole thing?
Yeah.
Were you sensitive to that?
I thought I was going to be really, really nervous because I was really nervous going in and then introduced the film. And I sat there and I just felt so proud and thrilled that these people were spending their time watching The Unloved. Mm-hmm. I just felt very humbled and like they could be doing anything right now and they're sitting here watching this film. So.
And is that... Do you feel like you're done now that the baby's out there? Or
no,
you?
I've got to take it around the world. I want to get distribution. I've got to find it. We've had some this things going on. It's quite exciting, right. And I've got to take it to other festivals. And
well, it's like we were talking to Soderbergh. The ongoing question with directors is when are you done with your film?
Yeah,
and he is like. When I finish it, I'm finished.
Yeah.
Like he doesn't want to see it again. He'll do the festivals. He's here with here with the movie and everything. But there are different moments where directors kind of sign off of that experience of their life and they're on to the next thing. But you're still in it.
I'm still in it. Yeah.
And you have any sense of when you'll be ready to kind of let it be a part of your history and not part of your present?
Well, it doesn't. No, I don't know that because I want to take it around schools and universities and colleges, and I want politicians to see it, and I want healthcare workers to see it. Mm-hmm. And the film is a message, so it will tell me when it's time for me to let it go.
And have you had any of those people from those communities that you know?
Absolutely.
See the movie already?
The second day that it was, after it had been broadcast in the UK, I had the government call me up and I went in and I'm working with the Secretary of State for Children and Families, Ed Balls. So I'm trying to help make reform in regards to the awareness of social work and that we need more people to become social workers and want to care about children and train and maybe have job changes. You know, someone could be from finance and decide, you know what, I've had enough of this, I want to go and help. And also the wages, there was a situation where the pay wasn't very good in social care and with social work. And the government has a massive incentive now to increase the wages, increase the training for the children. So
that must be incredibly satisfying.
I was really chuffed, but now I want to show it to her. I want to be on Oprah.
Oprah was here for 5 minutes.
I know.
She took on another social cause movie.
Didn't she?
Yeah. Well, it's not even Precious. A social cause movie, but yeah, Precious. It's.
I hear it's incredible.
Yeah. Well, I think it seems like your movie fits her, what she's going for also. So.
I just want to be on a sofa talking about it. That's all.
Because you want to hang out with Oprah, or you want to talk about the subject?
I want to talk about the subject to someone like Oprah who. Has an important amount, a huge amount of power in a very positive way, and I believe that she uses her power in a very positive way, and I think she's incredible. So, you know.
Is there anybody like that in the UK?
No, I don't think there's anyone like her in the world.
That's true. Well, the ladies of The View are the new.
Yeah, or just no. I've been on The View, but I don't think there's anyone like her.
Yeah.
Because she puts herself into things. You feel it. She actually puts her neck on the line. Her opinion. Whether you like it or not, she puts it out there. And she seems vulnerable at times as well, doing that.
Mm-hmm.
And she's a great actress.
That's true. So is there anything you haven't done in your career that you're now... I mean, besides a specific movie or whatever, is there another thing
I've
you want to do?
I've got an album coming out.
You have a singing album?
No, I'm joking. No. No. You wouldn't believe it.
Maybe you would go for the MTV Awards.
Yeah, imagine.
You wouldn't be the first.
No. What? No, nothing.
You seem very satisfied. You seem in a very happy, pleased place with where you are these days.
I am very lucky, yeah.
It's a nice thing.
But the funny thing, you know, I've got lip balm all over my face. Did I tell you that? Because like they said, oh, you got another TV. And I was like, great, is there anyone here to do my makeup? Yeah. I've been, you know, talking all day and I'm really tired. And I'm jet lagged and I'm going home in a minute and mm-hmm. miss my kids and all that. And it's like, no, it's like the end of the week. Everyone's gone. There's no one around. I don't have makeup with me. So I just put lip balm all over my face.
Well, you did a lovely job.
Kiehl's cranberry lip balm. I'm so sticky now.